I'd like to start by zooming out a little bit. As we've said, pre-calculus is kind of like the study of functions. We've defined functions, we've talked about some of their generic properties, you know, how to take an inverse of a function, when functions are invertible at all, how to graph them and transform them on a graph, or how to operate on them, whether that's addition and subtraction, multiplication, division, or a new operation like composition. And in particular, so far we've looked at two specific types of functions. We've looked at lines, which we can write them in an equation in a variety of different forms, such as y is equal to mx plus b. We've explored their properties on a graph, such as their slope and their y-intercepts. We can talk about lines that are perpendicular and parallel to each other and how that relates to slope, as well as utilize the slope of a line to give us a sense of how any other type of function is changing on average. We've also now discussed quadratic functions, which come in the form of y is equal to ax squared plus bx plus c. Right, the difference here is where in a line we had x to the first power, and we don't usually write the first, but it is there implicitly. The quadratics are really defined by being raised to the second power, or the variable being raised to the second power. And we now know all sorts of characteristics of these types of functions as well. For example, on a graph, they show up like a parabola, and other sorts of identifiable characteristics like their vertex. In today's video, we're going to introduce a new type of function called a polynomial. And it's not exactly so new because in reality, both lines and quadratics themselves are polynomials too. Polynomials is really more just a broader term. And so whereas previously we looked at lines and quadratics as these specific cases, polynomials is where we're going to generalize that a little bit more. It's a class of function that encompasses a whole variety of different types of functions, including lines and quadratics, cubics, and many others too. And so let's define specifically what we mean by the term polynomial. Now this is going to have a formal definition like all of the other things we've discussed in a math course so far, but let's break down the word polynomial itself, because oftentimes in math we name things in a way that it's going to kind of give us the intuition of what that thing is. And so if we look at the word polynomial, this is really broken up into these two distinct pieces, right? Poly meaning like multiple. You see this also in other words like maybe polytheistic, which would be a religion that believes in multiple gods. This in contrast with something that would be called monotheistic, which would be a single god. Or nomial, like nominal, is sort of representative of name. And now this root doesn't necessarily translate perfectly to what we're dealing with in math with equations and expressions, but I think sort of an alternative word here rather than name might be like term, right? Like we have a name for something, or what term do we use to describe something? So in this case, I'm going to use those kind of synonymously. But if we think about this in terms of term, right, what we're saying when we talk about a polynomial is a function that is of multiple terms. And if we look at the functions we have here, the lines and the quadratics, which as we've said are specific cases of polynomials, these are described by multiple terms, right? This mx here would be a term, and this b here would be another term. And so this line is described by multiple terms. We have in the quadratic an ax squared term, a bx term, and a c term. And each of these terms as part of our expression make up a multiple termed function, hence the name polynomial. And so really what we mean when we say that is kind of anything that looks like these equations, but we can expand that a little bit more. And so let's define this a little more formally. We'll need a bit of setup here. So the first thing we'll say is to let n be a whole number. And again, whole numbers are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on and so forth. And for however many terms there are, we're going to assume an associated real number with those. Now, to label that generically, what we'll do is say an, an minus 1, an minus 2, right, and so on and so forth, counting all the way down to a1 and a0. Right, and so for example here, if we had n equal to 5, then we would have a5 for an, and we would count down from there. So a4, a3, a2, a1, and a0. That may seem weird at first, or a little bit unusual at first, but you'll see that as we kind of do some examples, these an through a1, this list of numbers just represents the coefficients of our terms. And so for however many terms that we have, we're gonna have a different coefficient for each one of those, and that's really all we're trying to represent here is that list of coefficients for our function. But we will have one final stipulation, which is that an cannot equal 0. So the value with the largest index can't be equal to 0. With that setup, what we can say is that the function p of x, so the function p of x, which will be of the form an, so our first coefficient in that list, times x to the nth power plus an minus 1, just that second arbitrary coefficient in our list, times x to the n minus 1 plus an minus 2 times x to the n minus 2, right, and so on and so forth for however many terms that we have, all the way down to plus a1 times x, right, and implicitly this is x to the first, but we don't generally write that, plus a0, which is just a constant term, or again implicitly multiplied by x to the 0, which is just equal to 1. So again, we don't usually write that. And so this function here, as kind of crazy as this looks right now, is what we would define as a polynomial function. And so the function p of x is called a polynomial of degree n. And so what does this really exactly mean? Well, we could say that px equal to 5x squared plus 3x minus 1 would be an example of a polynomial, right? Because we have some coefficient times x to some power. We've got some coefficient times x to some power, in this case just 1, minus some constant term, right? And this really does meet this criteria we've outlined here, right? This would be our an, right? This 2 would be our n. This 3 would be our an minus 1, or our a1 in this case, right? And this 1, or this negative 1, would be our a0. Similarly, we could write out p of x equal to 10x to the 5th minus 1/2 times x to the 4th plus, let's say, minus 205x squared plus 13x minus 0.681, right? And this would also be a polynomial function because it fits this same form. We have a coefficient times x to a power. We have a coefficient times x to a power. We have a coefficient times x to a power, and so on and so forth. And any sum or difference of all of those types of terms make up a polynomial function. In this case, we would have a degree of 5. This highest power here represents the degree, and so in this case, n would be 5, and an would be 10. Now, this definition does have some nuances, so let's explore this a little bit deeper to distinguish this from some things that might look like polynomials on the surface but aren't actually polynomials. For example, the function f of x equal to, say, 3 times the square root of x. This would not represent a polynomial function, right? And the reason for that is because the square root of x we can also think of as x to the 1/2. Now, that 1/2 as an exponent, it kind of looks like it fits this format, except when we defined n, we defined n specifically as a whole number. So our exponents have to be whole numbers. So the exponents have to be whole numbers, at least to be a polynomial. Likewise, if we had a function like g of x equal to maybe -3 divided by x squared, right? You might say, well, this doesn't quite look as much like it is in this form as the previous one, but if we remember some properties of exponents, we know we also could write this as -3 times x to the -2. And now it does start of sort to resemble this, at least on the surface. But again, because of that same reason, we have to have a whole number exponent. This wouldn't classify as a polynomial because while -2 is an integer, whole numbers start at 0 and go up. They're only the positives where integers can be negative. So here, this to the -2 would tell us that this is not a polynomial. Now there are two other things I'd like to note in particular about this definition before we move on to exploring some of the properties of polynomial functions. The first is what we specifically mean when we say degree. So the degree of a polynomial is just the value of the highest exponent. So for instance, if we had p of x equal to 10x cubed minus 8x plus 5, this would be of degree 3 because x to the third, that to the third represents our largest exponent here. Likewise, if we had f of x equal to 10x to the third minus 4x to the fifth plus 8x to the seventh, we would call this a degree 7 polynomial because the highest exponent, the largest exponent, is that 7. Now, one thing that's kind of good to get in the habit of doing is anytime you have a polynomial function that's written out like this, would be to reorder it such that the powers go from largest to smallest. So the best practice is to reorder the terms of a polynomial so we go from largest exponent to smallest. And there's a number of reasons why we might do this. Number one, it does make identifying the degree a lot easier because we know that's also the exponent of the first term. But there are also a few things that we'll discuss later on, particularly with division of polynomials, that are going to become a lot easier if we already have them in this order. But also for now, this will help allow us to identify the leading coefficient, which is the second piece of note that I'd like us to take from looking at this definition a little closer. And we say that the leading coefficient, which we'll always label an of a polynomial, is the coefficient of the variable to the highest power, of the variable to the highest power. And so for example, if we look at our same polynomial px equal to 10x cubed minus 8x plus 5, the leading coefficient an in this case is going to be 10. And likewise, the function f of x equal to 10x cubed minus 4x to the fifth plus 8x to the seventh, we'd want to reorder that. So this was 8x to the seventh first, minus 4x to the fifth next, and then 10x cubed last. So we can identify the leading coefficient, or that first coefficient, the coefficient of the highest power, in this case would be 8. But let's hold on to these ideas of degree and leading coefficients for a moment. We'll come back to them later. But for now, let's see if we can also just look on a graph and get a sense of what these equations look like, how a polynomial function can be visualized. Now, two cases of this we're familiar with already, right? We already know what it means to be a line. We already know what it means to be a parabola. We can extend this even to a cubic function, which we've seen before. But when we start adding multiple terms, that's when these can get really interesting looking and have a lot of different variations. For example, if we look at the equation y is equal to 2x to the fourth minus 8x to the third plus 6x squared minus x minus 1, we can see that this equation starts from infinity all the way to the left, decreases for a while before starting to round up just a bit, and then hooks all the way back down to a valley, and then lifts back up and increases indefinitely as we go to the right. We can see that the function y is equal to negative 6x cubed plus 4x squared plus 7x plus 3 also starts decreasing from the left, and as we go down, eventually hits a valley and turns around to increasing, to hit a peak, to turn around again to be decreasing, and then decreases as x goes off to infinity as we keep going further right. And so these functions can have lots of interesting twists and turns along the way. And we'll get to talking a little bit more about those in a future video. But for now, let's explore what's happening in both ends. In this case, as we look all the way to the left, this is going off to infinity, right? This is coming from a really large place here and then decreasing as we move to the right. On the other hand, if we go all the way to the right, this function is getting smaller and smaller and smaller and is trending off to negative infinity. And in fact, all polynomials will do something like this. As we go right or left, they'll either tend off to positive infinity and get larger and larger and larger without bound, or tend down to negative infinity and get larger and larger, larger negative values without bound. And we can get a sense of exactly how that might work by looking at a few key parent functions here. X squared goes off to positive infinity in both the right and left direction. When we look at x cubed, on the other hand, that goes off to positive infinity as we look to the right, but negative infinity as we look to the left, right? As we walk along this blue function to the right, our values get larger and larger, but as we walk along this blue function to the left, our values get smaller and smaller. And then, of course, if we look at reflections of these, this is going to flip. It's going to be the opposite. Our x squared function now goes to negative infinity as we look both left to right, and our x cubed function goes to positive infinity as we look left and negative infinity as we look right. And this trend is not a coincidence. It's going to be a characteristic that we can specifically identify about any polynomial function based around the key differences of the degree of the polynomial, for example, x squared versus x cubed, and the sign of the coefficient, for example, positive x squared versus negative x squared. And by just looking at those few things, we can determine the end behavior of any polynomial. To look at this in a little bit more detail, we'll use what's called the leading coefficient test. In other words, we're going to utilize the leading coefficient of any polynomial to determine what happens as we look all the way to the right or all the way to the left. And so specifically, we can say that for any polynomial p of x, for any polynomial p of x, the leading coefficient an and the degree n determines the end behavior. In other words, what happens to the y values as x goes to positive infinity or x goes to negative infinity? As x increases without bound in either direction, so it goes all the way to the left or all the way to the right. And what we'll find is that we have four cases. Our degree n can either be odd or even, and our leading coefficient can either be positive or negative. In our first case, where our degree is odd and our coefficient is positive, as x goes to infinity, in other words, as we look to the right, our function p of x is also going to go to infinity. And as x goes to negative infinity, our function p of x is also going to go to negative infinity. In other words, we have a case that looks a lot like y is equal to x cubed, which, as we know, looks something like this. As we go this way to the right, our function is increasing without bound. As we go this way to the left, our function is decreasing without bound. And so we say, as x goes to positive infinity, so does our function. As x goes to negative infinity, so does our function. And I want to note here that I'm including this function here, this y is equal to x cubed, because all functions that have this nature of a odd exponent and a positive coefficient are going to have an end behavior that looks something like this. So in terms of remembering how this works, thinking back to those familiar functions like x cubed or x squared, as we'll see in a moment, are going to be really helpful to remember how these work. Right, because if we compare this to when n is even, what we'll find here is that as x goes to positive infinity, our function p of x will go to positive infinity. But as x goes to negative infinity, our function p of x will still go to positive infinity, at least in the case when our degree is even and our leading coefficient is positive, right? So for example, like in the case of y is equal to x squared. And if we think about what that looks like as a parabola, we know that this is indeed true. And we can think of this as a representative example of this whole class of polynomials, where we have the even degree and the positive coefficient. When our coefficient is negative, this will be like reflections of our previous example about the x-axis. So in the case of an odd degree, as x goes to positive infinity, now p of x will do the opposite of what we saw here. So where we saw up here it go to positive infinity, now it's going to go to negative infinity. And as x goes to negative infinity, we'll see this once again do the opposite of what we saw above. So instead of going to negative infinity, it's going to go to positive infinity. And all of these types of polynomials will behave like the function y is equal to negative x cubed, which as we know, looks like this. And in our final case, where our degree is even and our coefficient is negative, what we'll see is that as x goes to positive infinity, so as we look to the right, our function p of x goes to negative infinity, and as x goes to negative infinity, our function p of x also goes to negative infinity, illustrated by the example y is equal to negative x squared. This example here representing the behavior of all similar polynomials who have an even degree and a negative coefficient. And so we'll wrap up this introduction of polynomials by looking at a few examples to see if we can utilize the leading coefficient and the degree of the polynomials to determine what their end behavior looks like. Starting with f of x equal to 2x cubed minus x squared plus 5x minus 6, we're going to utilize the leading coefficient and the degree. In other words, we care about this term in particular and don't really need to worry about the rest of this so much. Right, so our focus is just on that leading coefficient and our degree, our largest exponent, because that's all we really need to determine the end behavior. And so in this case, we have a leading coefficient of 2, which is greater than 0, and we have a degree of 3, which is odd. And so a case of a positive leading coefficient and an odd degree is going to behave the same way as the function y is equal to x cubed, at least at the ends. And so if we think about what that graph looks like, something like this, we can see that as we go to the right on this graph, in other words, as x goes to infinity, our function f of x also goes to infinity. And likewise, as we go to the left along this graph, as we go to negative infinity, our function here also goes to negative infinity. And so as x goes to negative infinity, our function f of x also goes to negative infinity. And so our final answer would just be describing its end behavior in this way. And if we move over to Desmos and look at the graph, we can confirm this as well. As we look to the right, our graph goes up. As we look to the left, our graph goes down. We can look similarly at this function g of x. Now, g of x is a little tricky because it's defined as 6x cubed times x plus 1 squared times x minus 5. And this isn't written out explicitly in that same form of the previous polynomials where we just have a coefficient times x to a power. Here we have a product of a few things. However, if we imagined that we were to do this out, like in other words, to expand the expression and multiply 6x cubed times x plus 1 times x plus 1 times x minus 5 and do all of the distribution and all of the foiling, we could see that we would indeed get that same polynomial form. And although you're welcome to do all of the multiplication out, We can simplify our process in this case, at least in terms of end behavior, because all we really care about is the largest exponent and the coefficient that comes with it. And so really the only multiplication that we need to do is that of those first terms. In other words, if we look at 6x cubed and x and x and x in each of these places and multiply all of those together, that's going to be the term that has the largest exponent. That's going to be our leading term and have our leading coefficient. So instead of just multiplying every term, we just multiply the ones that are relevant for our problem here. We'll get 6x cubed times x times x times x. And this, of course, will be plus a whole bunch of other stuff, but we don't need that now, which is equal to 6x to the 3 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, or to the 6th. And now in this case, we have a positive coefficient, so an is greater than 0 since it's equal to 6, and we have an even degree. And so what that tells us is our function is going to behave a lot like y is equal to x squared, at least at the ends. In other words, at the ends, it's going to go off in the same directions that our typical parabola might. And so we can say, therefore, as x goes to infinity, our function g of x will also go to infinity. And as x goes to negative infinity, our function g of x will also go to positive infinity. And so it goes off to positive infinity in both directions. And so once again, we can look to Desmos to get a sense of how that's going to look. Now, here we've only graphed 6x to the 6th, and we know that our function has a lot more terms than that. We've just pulled the leading term. But again, the leading term is all that we need to determine what happens at the ends. So our actual function g might not look quite like this in the middle, but in terms of what's happening as we look both left and right, it's gonna go up to infinity in both directions like we have in this case here. I hope this video has served as an interesting introduction to polynomials. They're certainly a curious classification of functions, and there's a lot more nuances that we're gonna be able to dive into over the next series of videos. But at least for now, I hope you found this helpful. As always, if you do have any questions, please reach out and let me know. Otherwise, I hope you have a great rest of your day.